So I guess without further ado, I'll introduce today's speaker, Cerruti Hooks, who is an associate professor and extension specialist at the University of Maryland. He got his master's in weed science from NC State University and his PhD in entomology from the University of Hawaii. His research program is multidisciplinary and involves the use of conservation tillage and habitat diversification to influence above and below ground organisms. His research is conducted in conventional and organic agronomic and vegetable cropping systems. And his seminar today will focus mostly on the work that his lab members have been doing related to cover cropping, conservation tillage, to manipulate arthropods and weeds in conventional and organic systems. And I was very impressed. I saw Cerruti speak a few years ago at the International IPM Symposium got in touch with him to be part of this seminar series and the podcast, which I'll add the link in a little bit as well. So Cerruti, thank you so much for joining us. And you can go ahead and share your screen and get started.
All right, thank you. Okay, if everyone can hear me okay, I'll get started. So the title of my presentation today is A Fortuitous Partnership, the Tale of a Winter Cover Crops and Strip Tillage Crusade Against Pests. So I decided to give this presentation in the form of a book, and this particular book will consist of 6 chapters, and during each chapter I'll introduce a character. And I'm going to start off with clover. So clover is going to be our first character in this book, and I'm specifically speaking of red clover, Trifolium pratense. And red clover is a short-lived perennial. It's fairly low-growing, historically been used for medicinal purposes, such as cancer treatment, also for respiratory problems. It's reported to bloom from late spring to midsummer, but typically what we see, it basically blooms up until fall when it dies due to frost. And even if the bloom starts to die down, if you mow it, it'll come back into full bloom. It's typically used as a rotational crop for soil improvement, things such as building soil structure, also building organic matter content. It's commonly used as a forage crop. And one of the reasons why we like it is the flowers are accessible to and attracts a diverse species of pollinators. But however, my interest in red clover was whether it could be used whether we could use it to help manage insect pests. And with that, I bring you into chapter 2, where I speak of the second character in this book, and this is Hannah Windmill Call. So Windmill came to my lab as an MS student, and she had a specific interest in pollinators. And she wanted me to help her develop a project that will allow her to work with pollinators. However, she started during the summer, so we didn't have time to develop a project for her. So what I explained to her is that I did have a preliminary investigation where I was just starting to investigate some conservation biological control techniques for brown marmorate stink bug, as well as other stink bugs and bell peppers. And the project involved interplanting bell pepper with red clover. And along with that project, it had several objectives, and that was determining the impact of interplanting bell pepper with red clover on stink bug abundance, stink bug egg mortality, percentage of stink bug damaged fruits, marker fruit yield. And then we added another objective, mainly to because of her interest in pollinators, to also look at how this would impact pollinator community. So red clover is a cover crop that we typically plant in the late summer, early fall of the prior growing season, or we even can frost plant it as late as February. And this was a very simple 2-treatment study where we interplanted red peppers with red clover or grew red pepper in bare ground or monoculture. And I'm just going to focus on some findings with respect to objective 3 and 4 today. And the methods for this is basically we harvest the fruit from those 2 different treatments. And we sort of looked at the markability of the fruit, and we focused on those things that would make the fruit unmarkable due to insect damage. One being a European corn borer, which lays its eggs in the crown of the fruit, and then it bores inside of the fruit. And then also stink bugs, they would feed on the outside of the fruit and cause a discoloration. And we also, of course, counted the fruit and took the overall yield. So this first graph here is basically, this shows the proportion of damaged pepper fruits in those two treatments. And we divide this up into fruit damaged by insect overall, fruit damaged by the European corn borer, which is ECB, and that damaged by the stink bug. And the yellow bars represent the number of damaged fruits in the bell peppers interplanted with red clover, and the white, the monoculture of bare ground peppers. And we'll start with stink bug. And basically with respect to stink bug, we found that the proportion of damaged fruits were similar in both of those treatments, whether it was in bare ground and red clover. However, with respect to a European corn borer, there was a greater proportion of damaged fruits in the bare ground treatment. And it was because of this which contributed to the overall numbers being more damaged fruits being in the bare ground treatment compared to the red clover. And when we looked at pepper yield overall, we sort of divided this up, looking at the total number of fruits per hectare, as well as the yield in kilograms per hectare. And what we found was we did find a higher number of fruits in the red clover plot at about 43.6K versus 37.1K in the bare ground treatment. But the yields were statistically similar in the red clover plot at about 5.5K and about 5.3 kilograms per hectare in the bare ground treatment. So once we got through that preliminary investigation, it was time for Windmill to sort of come up with her own project. And the thing was, she decided that she wanted to continue to work with red clover because as the literature suggested, it attracted a diversity and a tremendous number of different pollinators. So she decided, well, I wanted to continue to work with red clover. So we had to determine a cash crop, and we decided to work with cucumber. And the reason why we chose to work with cucumber, at least the cultivar that we use, required pollination to produce fruit. So she thought it would be interesting to look at a crop that required pollinators to produce fruit and interplant that with a cover crop that attracts a diversity of pollinators. However, the one thing I explained to her that if you're gonna work with cucurbits in Maryland, and especially cucumbers, you're gonna have to deal with more than the pollinator community, because you're going to have various pests, such as the spotted and striped cucumber beetles, and then they're going to have their natural enemies, such as spiders, and then we also have some tachinid flies that may lay their eggs on the body of these cucumber beetles. So the objectives expanded a little bit. So we wanted to determine the impact of interplanting cucumber into this red clover living mulch on cucumber beetles, natural enemies, of course, pollinators, insect damaged fruits, markable yield. And we also looked at greenhouse gas emission to see if that would differ between the two treatments. And I'm going to focus on, show some findings with respect to objective 1, 2, and 5. So again, the treatments consist of red clover interplanted with cucumber, and then we had bare ground cucumber. And then there were several sampling techniques. There was visual counts when they did direct counts on the cucumber plants. We also used yellow sticky cards to help monitor arthropods within the different treatments. And then there was different color BBOs to monitor pollinators. And then they also did walkthrough counts as another method to monitor pollinator or to quantify pollinator activity in the different treatments. And there was a little bit of sweeping, but the sweep was more so to collect some pollinators to verify their identification. So let's start by showing some other results with respect to herbivores. So here on the x-axis, we have days after planting, and days after planting is always going to represent the days after the cash crop was planted. And this is the number of aphids per meter squared. And the little foliage sign here suggests that these counts were done directly on the cucumber plants. So the solid yellow line represents the number on cucumber plants interplanted with red clover, and the dashed white line in the bare ground treatment. And basically what we found on number of sampling days, we found that the aphids were of higher numbers on cucumber plants in the bare ground treatment. Now switching to a totally different herbivore, the striped cucumber beetle, and here we have two graphs. Graph A at the top, this represents the mean number of striped cucumber beetles per yellow sticky cards, and graph B below represents the mean number of striped cucumber beetles per meter squared directly on the cucumber plants. And we'll start off with graph A. So again, the x-axis represents the days after cucumber was planted, yellow, red clover, white dash, bare ground. And what we saw were somewhere around 28 days after planting, we start detecting a higher number of these striped cucumber beetles on the yellow sticky cards in the bare ground treatment. And if you look at the graph below, graph B here, you can see a very similar pattern when we did the counts directly on the cucumber foliage. Somewhere around 28 days after planting, that's when we start detecting higher number on the cucumber plants within the bare ground treatment. Now, switching over to look at some of the natural enemies. We are start off by aureus, or the minute pirate bug. And just in case not everyone is familiar with aureus, the minute pirate bug, it's a very small, generous predator. It's tend to feed on small, soft body insects, such as aphids, whiteflies, mites. It may feed on early instar leps and as well as insect eggs. And these are counts that we detected. These are numbers detected from the yellow sticky cards. So again, the x-axis represents days after planting, the white in bare ground, the yellow red clover. And with respect to aureus, we would tend to see higher counts in the red clover plots during the early part of the season. Then by late season, numbers become similar or even slightly higher in the bare ground treatment. And this sort of pattern was consistent between both years. Now switching to another generalist predator, the geocaris, or the big eye bug. It's a little bit larger than the minute pirate bug. It feeds on similar prey, but it can handle larger prey because of its larger size. And we've seen this feed on first, second, up to third instar stink bug nymphs. So again, the x-axis here, we have days after planting, white in bare ground, yellow in the red clover treatment. And basically on every sampling date, we detected higher number of the big eye bugs on yellow sticky cards in the red clover treatment compared to the bare ground treatment. And this also, this pattern was pretty consistent among the two study years. Now, what about yield? So here year, we have the mean fruit yield of the cucumber grown under these two cover cropping practice. We have our two treatments, the bare ground and also the cucumber interplant with red clover. We had started out by fruit numbers. And so basically the fruit numbers were numerically higher in red clover, but statistically speaking, the number of fruits were similar. And red clover, 118.5K versus 108.4K in bare ground. And a similar pattern with yield, slightly higher in red clover, but statistically speaking, these yields were identical. In red clover, about 40K, and in bare ground, about 29.6K. So with that, I introduce you to the next character, and this is Dr. Guiwan Chen. And Dr. Guiwan Chen is a soil scientist. And she was very talented. And one of the reasons why we hired for her for this particular project, it was a multidisciplinary project, and it had a heavy soil component. And we felt that we really need a soil scientist, but Gui was really talented in that it didn't matter the discipline of the study. If the study involved entomology, she could become an entomologist. If the study involved weed science, she could become a weed scientist. So she was one of those very talented researchers. And we're gonna focus on the weed aspect of the study. And this was a study that was done on ground that was transitioning into organic certification. And we used a rotation of eggplant and sweet corn during the four-year study. So with respect to the weed objective, it was to assess and compare the impact of two conservation tillage practice versus two conventional tillage practice on weed density and biomass, time spent hand weeding, as well as crop yield. So there was four experimental treatment. Our two conventional till treatment was the bare ground and black plastic mulch treatment. And in our conservation tillage was the no-till and the strip till treatment. And to the right there, you can see the two-row strip tiller that we used. And this would till only a 10-inch wide strip where we would plant our vegetable crop. And we actually ordered a wider strip tillage, but this came a little bit narrower than what we really wanted it. Now, all these treatments would start off with a cover crop, what we call a cover crop cocktail mixture of crimson clover, forage, radish, and rye. And we would typically plant these in late summer, early fall before the next growing season. So this is just to give you a visual of what those cover crops look like. So generally when you plant this mixture together, the forage radish is gonna be the only crop that really takes off late summer and through the fall and early winter. You get a really nice stand of forage radish and you look at their plots and there's little evidence that you planted rye or crimson clover. And then you have several nights of really cold weather, maybe late winter or so, maybe in the 20s or so, and the forage radish dies off. And then when you look out the plots and look at them in the spring, you see a nice stand of crimson clover and rye, and there's little to no evidence that forage radish existed in the plots. And once we got beyond that stage, the first thing we would do, we'd go out and we would flail mow all that cover crop leaving a residue on the surface. And then once we do that, that's when we start to, these treatments start to separate out. So we'll start with the bottom right, the bare ground treatment. So these plots will be plowed and disked. And when you, once they're plowed and disked, the cover crop will pretty much be is as similar as a green manure be plowed underneath the soil. And then we would plant our eggplant or sweet corn, and there's little to no evidence that cover crop existed in that plot. And then the above the top there, the black plastic treatment is very similar. Once we plow on this, we lay the black plastic, no evidence cover crop existed. And you may see a little white arrow pointing in the background, and that white arrow is pointing at a chamber. So another big component of this study was to look at greenhouse gas emission, see how these different treatments impact greenhouse gas emission. And then to the left, upper left, you have the no-till treatment. And in the previous, in one of the previous slides, you saw the farm manager flare mowing the cover crop. And that's basically all we do. Once that cover crop is flare mowed, we will plant the eggplant or sweet corn directly into that cover crop residue. And then in the strip till, once it's flare mowed, we come in with our two-row strip tiller. We make a narrow strip, till a narrow strip. And then within that strip is where the vegetable, the eggplant or sweet corn was planted. So let's show some of the results. And I'm going to start off with the weed biomass data. So I'm going to explain how we take this data before I show it. So the way we take our biomass data is we typically rope off a section of each plot. And that section is the section that we don't do any weeding. And the idea behind that is our interest is if we were to use these treatment and didn't do any rescue weeding whatsoever, how much weed biomass would build in that particular treatment, say within a month or 2 months or so. So here on the x-axis, it shows that data. We have the bare ground with BG, the black plastic, which are our two conventional till treatment. And then we have our no-till and strip till, which are our conservation tillage treatment. And this is the weed biomass, grams per meter square. Now, before I talk about the data, there's one thing I should mention here. So this particular study was done during the first year of that the transition study. And the crew panicked when that they looked in the bare ground treatment and they looked in the black plastic treatment. They saw a lot of weeds coming up. They said, we're not going to be able to handle this. So they did have the farm manager to come in and do some rescue cultivation. And unfortunately, that also impacted those areas that was roped off that were not supposed to get any weed. So in technique, in looking at this data, keep in mind that the bare ground and black plastic did have a rescue cultivation treatment. Now, getting back to the data, the eggplant was planted on 29th May, and this data was taken on 6 August, so about a two-month period. And basically what we see here is that the lowest amount of weed biomass was in the black plastic and the no-till treatment. And you see a lot of weed in the strip tillage, and a lot of that was came up just within that till strip because in the between row areas, that residue did a pretty good job of keeping those weeds suppressed. So moving to year two, one of the other things we do, we would time how much time it required to keep those plots clean, mainly be a manual weeding through hand pulling and using a hoe. So on the left, we have our four treatment, the bare ground, black plastic, no-till, and strip till. And they had a hand weed on 2 days, 18 June and 11 July. So let's focus all the way to the far right, the total category, the total amount of time required to keep those plots clean by hand weed. And we can see that the least amount of time was in that no-till treatment plot, followed by black plastic, followed by strip till, and then the greatest amount of time was in the bare ground. And I should say, during this particular year, there was none of the rescue treatment. So these are actually what occurred without any rescue treatment other than the hand weeding itself. So after that four-year study, I started thinking about how we can improve the system. One of the things we wanted to do was improve on the strip tillage system, because when we till that strip, we would get a nice flush of weeds within the crop row. The other thing was, how can we better manage weeds in the inter-row area? Because although that residue does a really good job of keeping those weeds suppressed, eventually it breaks down. And once that residue starts breaking down, those weeds start popping up. The other thing is the ability of that residue to keep those weeds suppressed is dependent on how much biomass we got from our cover crop. So, which can vary in like some of the springs when we have a lot of rain, that residue may break down faster. So I said, well, I decided, well, I want to focus on this particular issue first, because I already had some things that we could easily do different to improve that strip tillage system. And I thought, well, why don't we use a perennial cover crop? The idea is, if we use a perennial cover crop, it's going to live the entire duration of that cash crop cycle. It's not going to break down. So it should be able to keep those weeds suppressed the entire growing season. And then I decided, well, why not try red clover? Because of the good things I read in the literature about red clover. So that brings me to chapter 5, where I introduce the fourth character of this book. And this is Dr. Alan William Leslie. And Alan, or Will.i.am, who I call him, was trained as an aquatic entomologist. And a lot of his work involved looking at how agricultural practices in fields impact aquatic critters that you find in these irrigation ditches. He also was an adamant cyclist. He loves riding his bike. But I presented this idea to him, hey, what about you help me with this project where we're working with weeds and red clover? And he became somewhat excited about the project, because I guess he never really lost his interest in aquatic entomology, but he was looking forward to doing something completely different. So in this particular system, this was done in an organic system, and it was compared to impact of 3 conservation and 1 conventional till practice on weed density and biomass, time spent hand weed, and crop yield. And again, this was to try to see if we can improve on those techniques that we used during that transition study. So there was 4 experimental treatment. There was conventional till treatment, there was a no-till treatment, and then we added 2 strip till treatment. We had a strip till treatment where we used a roller crimper to terminate the cover crop, and then our first chance to try to use the strip till system with the living mulch to see if we could better control weeds in the between row area. So the conventional till, the no-till, and strip till roller crimp treatment consisted of crimson clover and rye, which was planted the prior early fall or prior season. And we used a seeding rate of 8 and 6 to 7 pounds per acre, respectively, for the crimson clover and rye. Now, and the reason why we use this rate is that farmers in Maryland can actually get cost share money to grow cover crops during the off season. They encouraged them to grow grass cover crops, but finally, we were able to convince the Department of Agriculture to allow them to mix some clover within their grass cover crop. And as long as they keep it at a low rate, such as something like this, they can still get the cost share money for planting the cover crop. And of course, the strip till living mulch was the one where we decided to work with the red clover. So this kind of shows what the treatment looks like early on. In the upper right, you have the no-till treatment, where we basically just flail mow it and plant the pepper directly into the residue. Then you have the bare ground treatment to the upper left there, where basically we use 2 paths with a rotavator and then planted the peppers into the bare ground. And then you have the strip till roller crimp treatment, the bottom left there. So that's if you look into that treatment, you can see that the rye residue is there on the surface, but you also see those green splashes. And this is basically the crimson clover had reseeded itself. And we like to see that, because when a crimson clover reseeded itself, it doesn't compete with the crop, but every place that a patch builds up, that it takes up a niche space, and we don't have to worry about weeds germinating in those particular areas. But in the strip till roller crimp, basically what we do is we use the roller crimper to terminate the rye, and then we come in with our 2-row strip till to make the strip till rows where we plant our pepper plants. And then finally, the below right is the strip till living mulch. So in this one, we will go in with our 2-row strip tiller, the tiller strip where we can plant our pepper plants. But then we will also come in with a rotary mower. And the reason why we come in with a rotary mower is to cut down the red clover a little bit, the height, and in doing that, we hope that we can eliminate any potential early season competition between the red clover and the pepper crop. So let's take a look at some of the results here. I should also mention that this particular study also involved an insect component to it. So this table shows the weed biomass and the bell pepper grown in those 4 tillage practice. And again, these are those areas within the treatment plots where we sort of isolate and we don't do any weed for a period of time. So we have our 4 treatments to the far left there, conventional till, CT, no-till, and the strip till living mulch with the red clover, and then the strip till roller crimp treatment. So the pepper plants were transplanted on June 15th, And you can see they took the initial weed biomass data on July 14, which is about a month they allowed the weeds to go before taking that biomass data. So let's focus on that July 14th date and specifically what happened in the inter-row or between row areas. And if you look into that strip till living mulch treatment, you can see that there was the least amount of weeds developed within that inter-row area in that strip till living mulch system, which meant that that living mulch was able to keep those weeds suppressed. Now, once we take that weed biomass data, then we do some weeding of those particular areas to clean them up. And then you can see they took biomass data again at August 8th. Now, at this particular time, there is no significant difference. And that's because by this particular time period, the pepper plants in all the plots had gotten sort of big and they formed a canopy so they can basically just keep the weeds suppressed on their own. So what about markable yield? Now, the markable yield was somewhat of a disappointment, but I can explain what happened here. So we have our four treatments here, the conventional till, the no-till, the strip-till living mulch, and the strip-till roller crimp, and this is yield in metric ton per hectare. And it's quite obvious that the significant highest yield was in that conventional till. The question is, why did that happen? First, let's explain what happened in the no-till and the strip-till roller crimp plot. So this reduction in yield in these plots was not due to competition. What happened is we had a significant proportion of diseased pepper plants that basically stopped producing fruit. And that's why we had a significant reduction in yield in these treatment plots. Now, with respect to the strip-till living mulch, similar to the conventional till, we didn't have any problems with the diseased pepper plant. But in that strip-till living mulch plot with that red clover, during the early part of the season, we had what we call a yield drag. In other words, the pepper plants were not yielding as well as conventional till during the initial three or four harvest period. Then once we got beyond that period, the yields became pretty much similar between the two treatments. And actually what we felt that if we would have continued to harvest beyond the time that we stopped, the yields would have become similar, because when we stopped harvesting, we noticed that the pepper plants in the strip-till living mulch treatment were producing more fruits and the fruits were larger. So I go back to what I was thinking about after a four-year transition study, and I want to improve the strip tillage system. I also see how can we better manage weeds in the inter-row area. And I said maybe using perennial cover crop would do that. And that seemed to work. It seemed to work by using that perennial cover crop. We could get better weed management in that between-row area. The other question was, how could we improve the strip tillage system? And one of the problem with the strip-till system is that we would get a nice flush of weeds within the crop row right after we do the strip-tillage. So I thought, well, why don't we take advantage of that? And we could use what we call the stale seedbed technique. And the stale seedbed technique is basically you allow weeds to flush up within a field. And then you kill those weeds with limited soil disturbances. And then you plant your crop. And the idea is that before you get that second weed flush, ideally that crop canopy will close up and therefore it's going to keep those weeds suppressed from being established just from having that canopy development. The problem with this technique is that we were trying it in an organic system and the herbicide that we were using at the time was not very effective on large weeds. It could only kill very small weeds, and to get a really nice to get that stale seedbed method to work, you want to have a nice weed flush and be able to kill them off. But unfortunately, that didn't occur with that organic herbicide that we were using at the time. So then we thought, well, why don't we just completely get rid of the strip tillage system? Let's try to think of something alternative to strip tillage that we can use that would work. And I bring you back to Will.i.am, and Will.i.am said, well, if you want to get rid of the strip tillage system, I think I have an idea, something that we can do and we can just eliminate it. And he said, why don't we replace it with a flame weeder? And the idea was that we would go out, instead of making a strip till with the strip tiller, we would just go and burn a strip with the flame weeder. And the idea was, and even if there are some weeds out there, possibly we can also smoke those with the flame weeder. So I said, okay, that sounds like a good idea. So he set up his four treatments again, the strip-till living mulch, the no-till, the bare ground treatment. And then the bottom left there where we used to be a strip-till roller crimp or roller crimp strip till treatment. He said, well, that's what we're going to make. That's the flame weeder roller crimp treatment. But he was smart enough to go out and test it on a small area of the plot. And when he tested, basically the plot caught on fire. So we learned a valuable lesson there. You can't mix a flame weeder with dry rye residue. So that brings me to chapter 6, where I introduced the final character of this book, and this is Veronica Yerchak, which we call V-Chak. And I should mention that Veronica also has a history as a MS student. She also started a fire in her research plot. So she had learned a lesson and said, well, I think we can come up with a method where we can do away with the strip tiller and we won't catch the field on fire. So that method involved, instead of using a cocktail cover crop mixture, we would use an interplanting cover crop mixture. And this mixture would consist of this a sort of pattern of where we would plant 2 rows of red clover and 3 rows of forest radish, 2 rows of red clover, 3 rows of forest radish. And we use a similar pattern for red clover and rye, 2 rows of red clover, 3 rows of rye, 2 rows of red clover, 3 rows of rye. Now you can see that these cover crops are planted at 6-inch row spacing. And the reason why we decided to go with 3 rows of forest radish or rye is because what this would do is give us an 18-inch spacing where we could plant our vegetable crop. And we felt that if we had this 18-inch row spacing to plant the vegetable crop in that center, we wouldn't have that competition issue with the red clover. And the reason why we felt this is that whenever we did our insect studies and we used red clover, we wouldn't use the 2-row strip tiller. We would use a hand tiller. And the hand strip tiller, the tilling width of it was 18-inch wide. And when we noticed that we never had that competition problem with our insect study. So we said, if we can have an 18-inch wide strip, then maybe we can reduce competition with the red clover. So the idea, as I mentioned earlier, is that the forest radish is going to die during the winter. Once it becomes too cold, it basically dies. So when that red forest radish die, basically now we got our little 18-inch strip without having to do any tillage. So the next thing we do, we go in with our roller crimper. And basically the roller crimper is to terminate the rye. Now, but you also notice that we use the roller crimper in the forest radish. And of course we don't need it because the forest radish is gonna die. But what we notice is that when we use a roller crimper early in the season, it sets back the red clover just a little bit. Of course it doesn't kill it, but it slows it up just a little bit. So we said, well, this may be another way that we can try to make sure there's no early season competition between the red clover and the vegetable crop. And then the idea is she was working with, V-Chak was working with sweet corn. So then the sweet corn would be planted directly in the center of that dead forest radish residue or the organic mulch left over by, or the rye residue. So this study, this particular experiment also had an insect component. It was a heavy on conservation biocontrol, and also V-Chak had an interest in pollinators, so that was also a component of her study. But we're going to just focus on the weed aspect for today because that's what we're trying to improve on. And so this research objective with respect to the weed aspect was to compare the impact of 4 cover cropping practice and 2 chemical practice on weed density biomass, time spent hand weeding, and crop yield. And this was done on conventional land, so this wasn't an organic study. So there was 4 main plot treatment, and then we had 2 subplot treatments. The main plot treatment was conventional till, the no-till, and then we had 2 living mulch treatment, the one with the rye and the one with the forest radish. And then the subplot treatment, half those plots received herbicide application and the other half received no herbicide. And the purpose of doing that, the interest was determined how well would these cover crop treatments compare if someone was to use their normal herbicide spray treatment. And the other question was, would a combination of herbicides and working with these cover crops give us greater weed suppression than either one of those treatments alone? So the herbicides were applied at planting. It was both a post and pre-emergent herbicide at planting. So the conventional till and the no-till, we went back to our cover crop cocktail mixture of crimson clover, forest radish, and rye. And then, of course, the living mulch treatment was the red clover and rye or red clover and forest radish. And this is just to show what the treatments look a little bit early on. And I don't know whether this was somewhere like 45 or 60 days after planting or so. But in the bottom there, you see the no-till treatment, the bottom right. And you can see that rye residue on the surface. And you see those small crimson clover plant. Because again, the crimson clover, it rained in the spring and the crimson clover reseeded itself. And I didn't mention that, but that's one of the things we also like working with crimson clover, because you don't have to terminate it. It flowers early spring and then it basically go to seeds and it sort of dies on its own, so you don't have to terminate it. Then in the upper right there, we have the red clover forest radish. You can see the red clover there, and the corn is planted where the forest radish used to be that died off. And then the upper left, that is the red clover and rye. You can see the red clover in the center, and then you see the rye residue here. And then the corn was supposed to be planted directly in the center of that residue. And then, of course, we have our conventional till where we will disc and plow it before planting the sweet corn. So we're just going to look at a little bit of the data here. We start with weed coverage. So here on the x-axis, this is the different cover crop management practice, the conventional till, the no-till, the red clover forest radish, and the red clover rye. And this is the percentage of ground that were covered by weeds at 60 days after planting. So the yellow bars represents the no herbicide subplot treatments, and the white shown by the pesticide tank is the herbicide subplot treatments. So what was really stood out was if you look at that conventional till, and you look at where no herbicide, the no herbicide subplots, about 100% of the soil surface were covered by weeds by 60 days after planting. And it's a huge difference between the percentage of soil covered by weeds where the herbicide were applied and not applied. Now, if we look at the living mulch treatment, we can see that that's difference between weed coverage between herbicides and non-herbicides. It's not that big of a difference. And if you look at the no-tills, there's a little bit of bigger difference than we saw with our living mulch system, but again, not what we see with when we're looking at conventional till. So this sort of suggested that the use of the herbicide was not a great benefit in helping reduce weeds in addition to working with the living mulch. So this also shows the weed biomass, and I think this was a 5 foot square. This data was taken from a 5 foot square quadrant. So weed biomass per 5 foot square quadrant. Again, the yellow represent the no herbicide subplot treatments, and the white, the herbicide subplot treatment, conventional till, no-till, living mulch forest radish, and living mulch rye. And again, if you look at the conventional till, you can see that it really made a big difference whether you use the no herbicides shown by the yellow bar versus using the herbicide in the white bar. And when you look in the living mulch treatments, you can see very little difference between the total weed biomass and the herbicides and non-herbicides. Again, indicating that the use of the herbicide did not offer too much additional benefits to just the cover crop treatment. And if we look in no-till, we can see the no-till benefit a little bit, but there wasn't statistical difference between the two subplot treatments. Now, I also wanted to show this slide. So this slide is to show what these plots look like during the second year. So basically, once we've completed that study, we went in and we mowed the sweet corn stalks and didn't do any additional planting. So if you look in the upper right, that's what the red clover and forest radish plot. So again, working with that red clover, perennial, short-lived perennial, we didn't have to replant it. And basically there is mostly red clover. There may be some forest radish in there that didn't kill and drop seeds. And then if you look in the upper left, that's the no-till treatment. We also didn't have to replant that. The no-till treatment was the one that consists of the forest radish, the rye, and the crimson clover. And I mentioned that the crimson clover reseeded itself, so it reseeded itself quite well. And we got another solid stand the following year. And you can see some rye in the background. And then the lower left there, that's the red clover and rye treatment. Again, you can see the red clover reestablished quite well. And you can see there's some rye. And typically we don't get that much rye the second season, but it meant that we terminated that rye a little bit too late, which meant some seeds must have dropped before we terminated. And then the bottom right there is just shows what we did. So we did have to come in with the two-row strip tiller, and we used the two-row strip tiller, the till strips where we planted the soybeans, and we looked at this study a second year, but we basically rotated in soybeans and we looked at how these different cover cropping practice could also impact weed suppression in a soybean system. And I should mention that the conventional till treatment, we did have to replant that particular treatment. So here I have some cliff notes. I know I sort of covered a lot, but these sort of cliff notes sort of sum up some of the things we talked about. With respect to red clover, what we found that red clover can be used for medicinal purpose and soil improvement, also feeding pollinators. In chapter two, the study with the bell peppers and the red clover, we found that the number of fruits damaged by stink bugs was similar in the two treatments, the bare ground red clover. However, we did find that the bare ground treatment contained a higher proportion of fruits damaged by the European corn borer. And we found that yields were statistically similar. In chapter three, clover and the windmill study with the cucumber and red clover, we found there was less striped cucumber beetles on cucumber plants in the red clover plots. I didn't show the spotted cucumber beetle data, but they were similar among bare ground red clover treatments, which is what we predicted. We did find that was more biological control agents detected in the red clover interplanted plots compared to the bare ground plots. And we found that yields were statistically similar among treatments. In chapter four, in our transition study with eggplant and sweet corn, we found that weeds were greatest in the bare ground. That's when we didn't do the rescue cultivation treatment. And also we found a lot in the strip till plots within the till strips. We found the lowest weed density overall was in the no-till treatment and also in the black plastic plots below the mulch, which simply meant that we didn't have weeds popping up through the black plastic. We did find that eggplant growth was slower during the initial year of the study and yields in the no-till during that initial study year. And that was expected because we had a very cool spring. Eggplant is a warm season crop. When you have all that residue on the surface, it doesn't allow that soil to warm up quickly. So the eggplant grew a little bit slower during that initial year. We also found that the quality of eggplant and sweet corn yield was tended to be better in the strip-till plots. So in chapter five, where we worked with organic peppers and red clover, we found that the least time spent hand weeding was in that strip-till red clover plots compared to the no-till, conventional till, and the strip-till roller crimp. We also found there was less weed biomass in that strip-till living mulch system during the early part of the season. And we found that yield was greatest in conventional till because of the disease issue and the yield drag issue. And in chapter six, this is a somewhat of a new study. But what we found during the initial year is that mixing red clover with a dime mulch, which is forest radish or organic mulch rye, provide better weed suppression overall than what we found in the no-till and conventional till treatment. So I go back to the initial question that I was asking when I initially became interested in working with red clover, and it was, can red clover be used to manage insect pests? And what I found is, yes, I think I wouldn't say rely strictly on red clover, but I think red clover can be a vital tool of an integrated pest management program targeting insect. But what we also learned is that red clover can also be a vital tool for an integrated weed management program. And with that, here I just acknowledge some of the funding agency, and I thank you for your time.
Great, thank you, Cerruti.
I'm going to stop sharing here for a second. Okay, there we go.
Okay, that was fantastic. Any questions from the crowd? We got about 5 minutes for questions. Feel free to either unmute yourself or type it into the chat.
I'm wondering what the disease issue was with the peppers in the no-till and strip-till treatments.
That is a mystery. Oh. So what we've found is, and that disease issue was every year of the study. But when we've taken it samples to the diagnostics center, and what they find is they found a lot of issues with the peppers, but they said none of these issues alone should have caused that problem. And then that person would share it with different colleagues in different states, and no one could tell us what was causing those peppers to die. The only thing they can say is we do find this and we find that on the peppers plant, but none of these should have been bad enough to cause the peppers plant to just die like that. So it's still a mystery.
Thanks.
Okay, a few more questions in the chat. Julie Suarez asks if there's an actual book to order. And I think she's referring to your outline But did you write this up also as a book, or?
No, it's not written up as a book.
Okay.
I only present it as a book because it's so much to cover.
Yeah.
To try to cover all that stuff. So I found that if I present it in the form of a book, it may be a little bit easier to follow.
Okay, Brian Nault asks about seed corn maggot issues in the no-till or strip-till studies.
Oh, luckily none whatsoever.
Okay, why do you think that was?
It may be because it could be the rotation system that's being used. Perhaps if we used the crops year and year that would be vulnerable to it, maybe we would have those issues.
Hmm. Okay.
And that's with my limited knowledge of the corn seed maggot.
Mm-hmm. Ignacio asks, did your soil scientist do some measurement of soil health parameters?
Yes, just what we use for soil health parameters, there's a nematologist that's also involved, and we use free living nematodes as an indicator of soil health. And I'm trying to remember. I can't remember where that paper was published. I think the paper is being written. It's been written. A draft has been written up. But yes, we did look at soil health, but using free living nematodes as a bioindicator of soil health.
Great. Jeff asks if you planted the rye alone, not with the red clover, would that change the C to N ratio and create a thicker, longer lasting mulch for the weed suppression?
Yes. Yes. I could certainly 100% yes, because so it's somewhat of a trade-off, but I think yes, in the end you would get greater suppression. One of the things we do find is that sometimes that rye and crimson clover mix, they tend to like each other. And sometimes we get really high biomass because when we use that combination. But one of the things we do have to deal with is that yes, the residue is gonna break down a little bit faster when you work with that crimson clover. So, but the trade-off to that is that we wonder, is the benefit that we get with having that higher biomass, having that crimson clover may still outweigh that benefit, because that crimson clover reseeds itself. And when that rye starts to die back, we still, in some instance, we have a real good coverage with that crimson clover. So it's somewhat of a trade-off. In those years where the crimson, we have a dry spring and the crimson clover doesn't come back, definitely it probably would have been a better benefit of just working with that rye.
Okay.
I think Elizabeth Lamb, I think I saw her hand up.
Yeah, let's just pause for a second. It is 12:20, so folks have to go. You're welcome to head out. Let's give Cerruti a virtual hand with the icon there. And for those with a special interest in the topic or with further questions, you're welcome to stay on for another 10 minutes. Betsy asks, or Elizabeth asks, did you find more aphids on the cover crop where you didn't find them on the crop?
I suspect that may have been. We didn't directly do counts on the clover. But I suspect that having aphids on that clover contribute to some of having greater predators in the area. Especially, I didn't show any ladybug data, but we did have higher ladybug data in the crimson clover. And we felt that the insect herbivore population on that crimson clover could have been helping drive greater population of some of those generalist predators that we found in the system.
Thank you.
Okay. And Christine asks, did you consider strip till followed by flame weeding as a treatment?
Actually, that could work in the, it could work in those systems where we work directly with the living mulch, because basically the using a flame weaver just in the red clover treatment wouldn't cause of fire. However, what we did find was I think V-Check used this in her study, is that we did find an organic herbicide that works quite well. If I remember correctly, it was called Home Plate. So with that particular organic herbicide, we can now go in into the red clover plots, and we can burn a strip in the red clover plots where we could now interplant the vegetable crop. And I think she actually used that during the second year of the study when we rotated in the soybeans. I think what happened was when we used the strip tiller, if I remember correctly, I believe the strip tiller didn't do a very good job. Maybe they didn't go deep enough. So what she said was within those rows, with strip till rows, there was still red clover, and that she would have had to plant the soybean directly into the red clover. So she went in, or she had someone to go in with this organic herbicide. They just backpack it. They burn a strip and then plant it directly into that burned strip. And the good thing we like about this organic herbicide, because it's not systemic, if we use something like Roundup, for instance, it would basically kill a huge whop of that red clover. But this would just kill only what it touched. So when they put a little shielded spray, it just made a nice little strip. And then they went, had the farm manager plant the soybeans directly in those burned strips. Mm. But the flame weeder could potentially do the same.
Okay. Hey, Brian, can I jump in here?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. I got another call to jump on here quick. I just had a couple questions. Fantastic presentation. I mean, absolutely great.
Thank you.
My first question is, what weeds were present when you were harvesting the weed biomass in Chapter 5?
Oh, boy. I would have to go back and look at that data.
Primarily grass or broadleaf?
It was a combination of grass and broadleaf. I think Elusa indica was one. Possibly wood sorrel was another one, a little bit of plantain,
but nothing serious like a Palmer amaranth or a water hemp or.
I think there was an amaranth, but not Palmer. And that's because Palmer isn't at this particular research station. But okay. I would say the dominant weeds that they have to deal with early on, it's going to be the grass, probably something like goosegrass, Elusa indica, and, I don't think we had foxtail in this particular study, but some plots we had foxtail, but I don't think it was in that particular field. But it's definitely dominated by grasses.
Yeah, great. And then my second question is, in your herbicide versus no herbicide study, what herbicides were you using since it wasn't an organic study?
Let me look right quick. I had that written down here. That was atrazine, cymazine, and metal, plus cymazine plus metal.
Metal, okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, and Ignacio asks, can you speculate on the effects of getting a grazing animal to help terminate the cover crop?
Actually, we thought about that one time. We call them weeder goats. We was wondering if we could get goats to come and graze the cover crop. But we never really tried it. But we thought about that. And we that could be interesting. It's something that we thought about, but never really followed through on it.
Yeah, and then something that we've talked about in the podcast that I found really interesting was thinking about or getting growers to think about which species that could serve as an insectary plant, as in attracting beneficial insects, which to kind of leave on the headlands or the sides of the fields, or maybe even plant in the fields, versus which ones to avoid. If you could speak a bit more on that.
And I would say, a lot of instances in our study, the cover crops that we use is dictated primarily what farmers can get cost share money to grow, because that's what driving Maryland farmers to, I should say, that initially drove them to plant cover crops, record acres of cover crop each year, is that when they were getting that incentive, that money incentive. But the good thing is, so a lot of times the cover crops, and that's one of the reasons why we want to try to convince the Maryland Department of Agriculture is to allow them to work with some of these clovers, because we felt that some of these clovers could also attract natural enemies. And although they terminate them, maybe they could attract some during the early part of the season before they terminate them, and they would stick around. And then that's what sort of involved in us trying to work with these living mulch, because we said, yeah, that's good, but sometimes when they work with these clovers or these other cover crops that we know attract natural enemies, they terminate way too early, and they don't get the benefits of them because they leave. So if I was trying to use it strictly as insectary plants, we may not work with some of the cover crops that we're actually working with. We may look at some of the, because another thing is Maryland are encouraged to do is plant these, what we call pollinator meadows. It started out as these conservation resource plantings. And then they morphed into saying, okay, we want you to specifically plant these pollinator meadow plants. And they can also get money to put a piece of the land off to look at that. So I would say if I was really looking into something, I would say, well, these are something that you may want to plant in areas of your farm. It could be the grassy ways, areas where they typically don't plant the crop. I would probably start looking at some of those pollinator plants, because they bloom at different time of the year. That the way they set it up, the recommendation is that they have these plants that bloom during the early part of the season, the mid part of the season, also the late part of the season. So they always have something blooming at all the time. And it would be some of those plants that probably I would start recommending farmers to start looking at as far as insectary plants.
Okay. And maybe one final question here from Ethan. Are the results of the greenhouse gas flux analyses in the first trial you just discussed available?
The one for the transition study, that was published. And let me try to remember the results. If I remember correctly, the black plastic treatment gave up the greatest greenhouse gas emission. The no-till treatment was the least amount, followed by, let me see, the strip-till treatment. And then what was the other treatment? There was the no-till and the conventional till. I think the conventional, it was black plastic most, followed by conventional till second most, followed by strip till, and a no-till gave off the least amount of greenhouse gas emission.
Hmm.
And we found that kind of interesting, because we said that when we thought about the black plastic treatment, we felt that, well, even if it didn't do very well, in other words, I mean, it did well. In other words, we say, well, there wasn't much greenhouse gas emission. The way we looked at it, well, if we took in consideration, there's a lot of greenhouse gas being emitted in the preparation of the, in the building of this black plastic, then it would still be an issue. But we found it very interesting that the greatest amount of greenhouse gas emission was from the black plastic, and also greenhouse gas is emitted in of course, making the black plastic. So we found that quite interesting.
Yeah, double whammy. Okay, if you have time to stay for one more, Jeff asks, we have final dates for cover cropping planting supported by government programs that reduce the planting of cover crops in New York. Are there similar problems with final dates and timings in your area?
It could be of inconvenience to some farmers, because for those who are in the cover crop program, there is a certain date that they have to have that crop planted if they're going to get those benefits. And say if something goes wrong, in other words, they can't harvest their soybeans until late for whatever reason, it rains, they can't get in the field, then they may miss that date. But if I remember correctly, I think in some instances, the state take that into consideration. And I think sometimes they extend the date for them. And another thing sometimes they encourage them to do, which some farmers are doing, is they seed their cover crop in say like in the soybeans once it dried down, or even their corn before they harvest. And the idea is, you know, the cover crop is not gonna come up and compete with the crop at that time, but then they've already have it planted and they got it planted in time to meet that date. And if something should come up where they can't get in and plant it, it's already planted. But yes, sometimes having that date established for farmers can be somewhat of an inconvenience for them.
All right. Well, I think we're out of time, but Cerruti, that was awesome. Really appreciate your being able to join us today. And
if they have any questions, feel free to email me.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Cerruti.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Take care.
Bye.